It's a very good Monday morning, and this is Y254 TV, the best youth TV in Kenya. And my name is Oguda Bradley Sankara Kayesu. I hope your weekend was superb, was good. Unfortunately, it was not so good for Ram Aguko, who do host this morning show. And he's sick, he's about sick, and we pray that he becomes better soonest possible. And it's a bit rainy in Nairobi, cold as usual in Nairobi, and it's
It's good to be up on this chilly morning. Yeah, we want to thank God for this day. And say, as we say good morning to our viewers and all the Kenyans, it's good for us to appreciate that it's a blessing to be here. And we also want to thank the entire KBC family for giving us this opportunity to talk to fellow Kenyans and have conversations around issues that affect us.
You are a governance expert.
Yeah, so my name's Kennedy Odweo. I'm a governance expert. And I'm also very involved in matters of leadership and youth development. And I'm also a parliamentary aspirant for the Butula constituency in 2022.
Oh, you're going to vie?
Yes, sir.
Oh, that's nice. My name is Oguda Bradley Sankara Kayesu once again, and I'm a senior comrade. So my senior comradeship is going to help here in in delving in these matters, politics of the day. We are going to start with the newspaper review, and with me here is the People Daily. And in the front page is the nomination test for the Big Four. So the Big Four here are the DP William Ruto, former Prime Minister Raila Amolo Odinga, and then Kalonzo Musyoka, and then Musalia Mudavadi. It is not news, or it's not strange, that one of these four are going to be our next CEO of the country. Now, this paper is saying that there's big headache in who they are going to be choose as their running mate, as they are fumbling on balancing the tribal axis of Kenya, rewarding those who have been loyal to them, and all that. So, Brother Kennedy, who do you think, why do you think this is quite a matter in this country?
I think our politics has always been shaped or rigged in a very in a tribal, and sometimes they will call it political party patronage, but it's fairly and largely tribal. So you realize that the way we've organized our politics in the tribal setting, we are in a situation where loyalty matters more than performance. So you realize that for all these tribal bigwigs, all of them have their loyalists who have been drumming up their support and who've been on their side. So it becomes a headache when it comes to nomination.
Yes.
Because now there's someone who has been with you, who's been, some of them are even doing the dirty work for the big wigs, and now there is another person who is more qualified and the people who can relate better with the people. So it becomes a headache when it comes to the time of nominations. And as for the issues of the running mates and whoever will be the CEO, I think for me at the moment it will be a bit of a tough call to make, because as we know, we are still having some background arrangements, and as we all know, the organizations, all these people are trying to protect their interests. So in protection of their interest, and that's why you hear there, of course you'll hear them talking, everyone trying to pull in their corner, but it's just a matter of everyone trying to raise their stake.
Who do you think is going to be your guess, your wild guess, to be deputy president's running mate? Or which region do you think is going to come from?
I think, in my opinion, there is a way. If you look at the way things are going, it's a tough call to make. Because if you look at everything, you can see a situation where everyone is either being pulled or everyone is pulling away from the DP.
Mm-hmm.
There's a deliberate attempt by someone, or deliberate attempt to alienate.
So to join him or to push away from him, depending on the area from which you come, or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, because look at the way things are organized. You find these people always meeting either at State House.
Yes.
There are these small organizations. You see even conversations around. You find that the DP is a man running his own show.
Yes.
Singularly.
Yes.
With a few, let's say, members of parliament and senators. But when you come to those we consider the big fish, I feel like there is someone or there's a force that is pulling the rest of the others. You see the Right Honorable Raila Odinga, Musalia Mudavadi, Kalonzo Musyoka, Moses Wetangula, and even Gideon Moi. Because at the end of the day, you may dispute, like you may write of people like Gideon Moi, but Gideon Moi comes from a certain, there's a certain representative part of our society that he comes from.
Yes.
And as a person, he comes with something.
Yes.
So deeper analysis will tell you that that is also another part of an equation. But then you realize these people are being pulled in one corner.
Mm.
The only problem we have is how these people are going to agree and share whatever is on the table.
So back to my question, your wild guess on who you think DP may choose. Then you'll tell me the former Prime Minister. Who do you think, if you can't name the real person, then you name the area that person is likely to come from?
In my opinion, the DP will be better served with a running mate from the Mount Kenya region.
And the former Prime Minister?
The former Prime Minister is also angling for the same.
We'll get deeper into that when we get to our youth and politics segment. Now there is another story of this lady on page 2. Page 2 says police intensify hunt for the suspected killer. There's this lady called Kangogo Caroline. This lady has been on the run now. I think this is the second week. Why do you think is our detectives something, why don't they get this lady? What do you think is the problem here?
I think for me the first thing I would like to say is that as a country, I usually say as a country we are a sick nation.
Mm-hmm.
People are going through a lot and it's high time as a government, the government came up with mental health. It's time that as a country we discussed mental health as a serious issue.
You think this lady is a mental health victim or something?
I don't think someone can just wake up and start killing people unless there is something that has happened. And at the end of the day, such reactions are always as a result of someone's inability to handle extreme psychological deviations from the norm.
Yes.
On the detectives, I believe this is someone who has been in the system.
Yes.
As a police,
and as a
is
detective.
It constant or corporal or
yeah?
Yeah. So as a person who has direct access to the system, she's someone who knows how everything operates.
Oh, yes.
So it's easier for such a person to escape the arm of the law.
Mm.
But at the end of the day, I believe in the long term, the law always catches up with
her.
She will be apprehended. And I think it's just a matter of trying to enlighten the public.
Yes.
Because now she's a security threat to the people.
Yes.
But I think as we even discussed that issue,
yes,
it's also good to take the other side of the conversation so that we try to understand why are we getting where we are. Because at the end of the day, this is not a new case.
Yes.
It's just being amplified because maybe she's a cop. But
yes,
we have people killing people everywhere because of small disagreements. We have a lot of cases of gender-based violence. And these are issues now. I come back to the issue of mental health. As a country, as a society, we've never embraced mental health to the levels where we should.
You are in the news nowadays, like top 5, from 1 to 6 news item about killings.
Yeah, yeah.
That is unfortunate as a country. I hope we will get back to what we should be, because it should be a peaceful nation. People should not be fighting each other.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about COVID. Do we entirely blame the COVID pandemic for this?
No. For me, COVID has come. But like I always say, as a nation, we had already sunk by the time COVID came.
Mm-hmm.
So COVID is a good cover-up.
Okay.
But you know, as a people, I think it's high time we also relook at everything. COVID has really affected people because as a country, we were not in a position to come up with real-time measures. And as a country, I always say we are an emergency country. We wait for things to happen and then we mobilize ourselves
around
reactive.
That.
We are very reactive. So COVID now was not a one-off thing or a 2 days thing, the way floods will happen in Budalangi and then we can mobilize
people
the AMREF. There will be a small, maybe Solai Dam will collapse.
Mm-hmm.
That is the situation we are used in. So when we go into a situation where we have an elongated period of a pandemic, it becomes very difficult to handle.
Just little on that COVID, there is something in page 3 that is a bizarre. like they are discussing several ways people are fighting COVID in page 3. And first is about some Indians. They don't know who told them, but they believe that when you smear cow dung all over your body, then you are safe from COVID. There are also people, this is India, there is a photo of some Indians, some human beings, green all over their body because wamepaka cow dung all over their body. I don't know how cow dung, but I think these people believe in cows are sacred, cattle are sacred according to them, so it's like it's everything that comes from the cattle is just enough for them to protect them, but that is weird. There are also people, there are also Al-Shabaab just the next door, who believe that they have called their people, those the loyalists of the Al-Shabaab, to reject the AstraZeneca vaccine and entirely depend on honey. That if you take black seed honey, then you're safe. Like that is their prevention. That is how they vaccinate themselves. You just take honey, then you're just good. And then there's another story coming from Spain. There was a lockdown in Spain. It's not been fully opened now. So you are not allowed to walk out unless you are walking out a pet, like when your pet wants some exercise, so you are walking your pet. There was a guy there who decided to, there were two people who did bizarre things about that, because you are allowed to walk with a pet and people like really need to walk out. So somebody tied a chicken and started walking with this chicken, that the chicken is the pet. And there was a person who also took a bowl of fish, walking with fish in the street, that the fish is the pet, and now he's walking. But this guy, this particular guy, was arrested. And then there was also in which country is this? UK. There was lockdown and everything was shut down, and the people who were most affected were ladies, or I call them in Kenyan language slay queens, who the lips shop, the shop that does their lips, was shut down, and now they had very dry lips and everything were out of place for them. There's a photo of a lady injecting her lips with some drug. I think the alternative that they were given that they can do. And now they are saying that those who depended entirely on those who do their lips have very dry lips now, and they're very desperate on what to do, because they say the lips, like doing the lips, would spread the coronavirus faster. So they are avoiding all that. And then lastly, in Belgium city, there's this say that there are poops everywhere. I find this very strange, because I take these places like Belgium, the European countries, as very developed, but they say that the public toilets have been shut down because of COVID-19. So like adults do it the way we used to do it when we were young in the village, just in the open, and there are poops everywhere. So it's like worldwide coronavirus has wreaked a havoc. But as Kennedy says, I don't know whether it's only in Kenya where there this, you told me before that this is just a scapegoat. And you see it's wreaking havoc in the whole world, and the countries that we don't think could act weirdly are acting weirdly. What do you say about this, Kennedy?
Yeah, I think to clarify something on, like for their countries, yes, there are lockdowns, but the lives of the people have not been shut the way the lives of the people in Kenya have. So in society where people are already organized and their systems are functioning, it was easier for them to come up with measures that will ensure that, okay, yes, life has been disrupted, but there are strategies to ensure that, to mitigate, to ensure that people don't fall into the abyss. Mm. For what is happening, like for example, for the people who are rejecting the COVID, there are even people in Kenya who there's been a lot of propaganda about it. Personally, I've gotten both the jabs, and I think I haven't felt anything much.
Oh, yeah. People say there are strange feelings that people feel when they take the jab. You confirm that you're okay.
Yeah, you get
just
them.
As you were before you took it.
You see, any new substance being injected into your body, even when you take Panadol, you'll feel something.
Yes.
So it's normal. So at the end of the day, that's where it's usually said. You'd rather believe there is God, so that when you die and there's no God, you have nothing to lose than believing there's no God And then when you die, you find God and you have truth.
But that is playing two cards. Like, no, you are in two ways. You just believe God. You don't have to
believe there is God.
Yes.
Even if there isn't, you have nothing to lose.
You don't have to have that other option of even if there isn't.
You don't need to have that option. So, like for COVID, I always advise people. I've gotten the jab. I felt the side effects, of course. But then after 3 days, everything is okay. I went for the second one it was around 10 weeks. I'm good. So at the end of the day, COVID is scientific. We have scientists who've told us that the world is largely scientific. Inventions and innovations that we enjoy today are scientific. So we have a situation where there are people who are hell-bent on trying to create a different set. Okay, the economic consequences and all that aside, we need to protect ourselves.
Yes.
This is a flu. We've seen people die. Mm. Not just the normal. It's not like cases where normal people are dying.
Yes.
As in normal in quotes. Uh-huh. We've seen the big fish. We've seen very, very rich people die. So at the end of the day, we need to find a way of protecting ourselves. And one of the ways of protecting ourselves at the moment is through the COVID vaccine. And if it's available, I'll always advise people to take it.
Thank
for the
you,
people
Kevin.
Who are smearing dung and all that stuff, like sometimes I say desperate times,
call for desperate measures.
But science is science.
But you know, those desperate measures can't work.
No,
because I don't think COVID can see cow dung and say, this is cow dung, now let me keep away. I know the people who believe that they get careless, they say, now I'm protected.
Yeah.
Their God is protecting them.
Yeah.
So let's not juggle with our lives. Let's not take things are normal, so you can go to your tradition so that your tradition will inform the decision you are taking. Let us be strict, do what the government has told us, because it is science. When it gets to the body, that's how it reacts. So there are people who have studied this. I always call that if there's an expert in a given field, you listen to him. There are people who I call know all, tell it all, or jacks of all trades. We generalists call ourselves so. We are jacks of all trades, that we can decide on, we can comment on any other matter. So advice that Kennedy has also given, that you be strict on what you have learned. And if somebody is talking as an expert, like our health experts in this country, listen to them so that you take their advice. Let's move from COVID.
And maybe if I could just mention something.
Yes.
I would like to remind Kenyans that science is not like law, where someone just studies some English and then crams some verses from judgments of 1925 and then they can quote. Science is a rigorous process that involves even testing using, we have guinea pigs, we have people taking the risks to have their bodies used as tests for the sake of humanity.
I don't know if that science is also dynamic.
Mm.
Like what was there in 70s may be very different. That's why I think there's no precedence. You know, in law there's precedent.
Yeah, there is.
How was a judgment given in some year, in which country? Mm. It can be used in Kenya now. But now the test that was done maybe in 70s or 80s or 60s in UK, things have really changed. Like now, what was there may not be here, so the research may be needed again and again.
Yes.
I agree with you. Okay. There is, on page 4, there is about jitters over Raila's turn up in Ukambani tour. Like they did not expect Raila to go. They were really expecting the president. And now a former prime minister also showed up. And now there was a whole discussion of NASA, unity, and all that. Why do you think this guy decided to accompany the president to Ukambani when it was not expected?
You know, one thing that Kenyans need to understand is that take away everything from the right honorable, but Baba is Baba. Baba turns up when least expected, sometimes in a good way, sometimes in a bad way. Baba will disappoint people, but the same people tomorrow will be. So at the moment, you can say Baba is like a co-president.
Yes.
So Baba can pop up anywhere, with or without the president.
Yeah.
So whenever the president is doing some of this project, the right honorable will always be there on most occasions. And there's also this word about how the 2022 arithmetics and all that stuff. So personally, I will not be surprised if the president is opening, is launching a project in Busia and the right honorable is there. So it's both political and also part of the handshake arrangement, where we also know that there's a lot of contribution.
Isn't he officially one of the administrators of this government? Now that you talk, you say there's both politics and the administration.
As per the government structure.
Like, let me give you an example. Yeah. Yesterday I saw him, I think he was in Narok, and he officially renamed Narok National Stadium to Lentimama. Is that his function? Is he like acting extravagantly?
That's now the magic of being in Kenya, that we have people who do not have official public portfolios, but they operate like they do. So at the end of the day, he may not have a position, but the truth is, at the moment, the Right Honorable is contributing a lot as far as the running of the government is concerned. So to a point where, if he can ride in an Air Force chopper to a function, if he can be, if government functions can be delegated to him, because such functions are supposed to be done, for example, if a function is supposed to be done by undertaken by the president, the president either delegates to the principal assistant, who is the deputy president, a minister, or any other government official with the sufficient designation to do that. So when the president designates such functions to the Right Honorable Prime Minister, it means their duties is undertaking.
We'll come back to discuss whether these people, the NASA people, will unite, because the person who appeared most surprised that Raila was in Eastern Narok Kambani is former Vice President Kalonzo Musyoka. And there was also a whole weekend packed with politics, with Musalia Mudavadi, the ANC leader, speaking something about NASA unity, which was not far much positive, but we'll discuss that when we come back to youth and politics. There's now this story about Obado murder case, still in, on page 4, that Obado murder case start after attempts to postpone it flopped. You know, this is my governor, come from Migori County, and what I want you to say about this is whether you think the trial is taking too long, because when did this happen? Was it around 2-3 years ago?
Yeah.
And now the trial had not started.
Yeah.
And there was this trial of the lady, there was somebody in Mombasa who was dating Kerochi Brewery's CEO or founder daughter. And they finished very fast, and I think that guy was either acquitted or sentenced or so that. And that was about 1 year ago or less. Do you think the government is flopping or taking too much time in bringing justice, especially when these big fish are involved?
Without seeming prejudicial on matters that are before a court of law, I will just pedestrian, you can see the difference, because we all know we have a system that is, I think, skewed towards those people with the resources. So you realize that a common Kenyan will be apprehended today and can be sentenced on the same day. But you see, when it comes to the big fish now, it doesn't matter the crime. You see now the wheels of justice really engage, the lowest gears are engaged. You just made a very good comparison, the case of the Migori governor and the one of Omar Lali in Lamu. Actually, it took a public uproar for Omar Lali to be released, and then at some point the charges were quashed, a public inquiry was launched, because you will feel like there were exerted efforts to ensure that he goes to jail,
yes,
without due process being followed. So you see the two sides, and then you realize that at some point I feel like, okay, we have systems that can work, but I think for the big fish, resources can sometimes delay some of the processes, especially when the defendant or the person on the other side does not have an equal magnitude of. So it's a very unfair situation, and it's something we need to look at as a system, so that we have a system that judges all using the same law and the same rule.
There's another story on page 5. That there's a motion that has been, this being drafted by Garissa Township MP Aden Duale, that commands that if you forward an SMS or share a nude on WhatsApp group, or send to someone SMS that is nudie or something, then you risk being jailed for 25 years. 25 years. And you know what the youths, those who are our main audience of this show, are millennials, and what they do with the news, not all of them, but a few. It's not easy to get an adult or an aged person sending a nude unless there's something wrong with them. Now, brother, or the MP, Aden Duale, is forwarding a motion that says that if you forward a nude, if you send nude, then you can end up spending 25 years in jail. Your take on this?
I think it's the same thing. I go back to mental health, psychological.
You think people forward news because they have mental health?
No, I think as a society we've degenerated morally to a point where anything goes.
Yes.
So I think it's a good thing, because at the end of the day we've seen stories and all that where people's nudes are being shared. It's being used as a blackmail tactic. So I think for me it's a good thing. It's supposed to deter, because at the end of the day, you see, there was that issue, without mentioning it, where maybe someone will record you,
yes,
and then use that as blackmail. And there are those who even send as a way of seducing people and all those things.
Yes.
So I think these are some of the things I would say as a society we need to build our morals,
yes,
and be able to civilize ourselves mentally,
yes,
to a point where we don't need to engage in such things.
Yes.
And I think that would be a good deterrence. But 25 years, of course, is a joke.
Yep, anyway. You think it's a joke?
Ah, it's a joke.
So you don't want people to be jailed 25 years. At the same time, you don't want people to send these nudes or
I
something.
I think sitting down to discuss 25 years,
yes,
for someone who took a nude photo of themselves and sent to someone, or took your photo while you're doing your thing, I think for me, that energy will be spent more in trying to craft strategies that we can infuse in our education and academic systems, so that people grow up knowing that there's no need to send someone a nude.
And by the way, they're using it to blackmail leaders.
Yeah, yeah, they're using it. Now, if we need to create a society and a system where our young people are able to understand their value to a point where you don't need to expose yourself for your value to be seen. And for the young boys, you don't need to see some of these things for you to feel like a man and like that.
Without naming names, there was a recent video clip of some lady who went with a leader into those private rooms. Then when this leader was like drunk and tired, sleeping, they took a video of the whole of this person, including everywhere, and shared it. I think they didn't share it first, that this lady was like demanding some cash, that I have your video sent to him. I said, if you don't sort me this amount, then I'll post this video in public and you'll be embarrassed. See where we are going as youth of this country. I think it's a youth that did that. What do you think about this blackmail things and all that?
It's a catch-22 for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's wrong to do that. It's criminal to record someone without their consent.
Yes.
But at the same time, Pia, as leaders, as men, and let's stay straight to our vows. There's no need. I usually say, as a person, we make decisions, and when we are making those decisions, the problem is that we make decisions, but we don't want to be held accountable until something happens. So for me, it's both sides.
Okay.
Both of them made a mistake, and we need to find a way as a society of ensuring that we live the life that we promise our society, we promise our mothers, we promise our wives and husbands. But at the same time, as daughters and sons, we also need to live a life that the Bible proclaims upon us,
yes,
so that we are straight citizens. We go to school, we tusome, tupate ile tunaweza, we do business. If our parents cannot provide enough for us, let's work and make something for us. Let's humble ourselves, live within our means, and move forward as society. That's a better society and a safer society for our children. But this society we are creating is very dangerous.
Thank you, Ken. Page 8 is about the UDA Jubilee, UDA Jubilee politics in Kiambaa. And the headline says, UDA Jubilee leave nothing to chance in Kiambaa campaigns, as their last-minute campaigns. When is this election? Should it be tomorrow or something?
Mm-hmm.
When are the elections in Kiambaa? I think it's tomorrow. I'm looking for it. Yeah, but now the campaign ended yesterday, something like that, so people are going to polls. Who do you think is going to carry the day here?
I think I wouldn't make a call.
Uh-huh.
I wouldn't make a call considering how things have gone in the by-elections.
Uh-huh.
There is a lot of muscle juggling.
Uh-huh.
There's sibling rivalry between UDA and Jubilee. There is someone who is trying to... There is a house that is being considered to be on fire.
Yes.
And it's trying to demonstrate that it can still stand on its own.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a new house that has been put up using some of the materials that house that has now been put on fire. So it's a matter of a new crop that is being pushed up forcefully versus an old crop that is being pushed down. So it's a balance. So whichever way it goes, there's no difference. These are the one and the same thing.
Because we are going to discuss this more on youth and politics. That we are just we're going to delve into like in 10 or so minutes. But page 11 is talking about what you've been really speaking here about the mental illnesses. There's a report that said that our police, especially, are very mentally ill. Our police, because of the economy, because of what they go through, because of a plethora of things that are not nice to them. Oh, how do you think we can help this?
I think at the end of the day, we need to do a responsibility analysis. It's called a responsibility versus remuneration of analysis of our civil service.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the risks that these people are subjected to, you look at the scope of their duty vis-a-vis their remuneration. And at the end of the day, the problem is not remuneration.
Uh-huh.
The problem is, do we have capacity building and mental support programs
yes.
effective within our security systems?
Yes.
Because at the end of the day, what these people are subject to, we see some of these things even on the road, the way some of them are abused.
Yes.
We see them being abused by people on the road.
The police.
This person, at least we need a system that can ensure that they continually engage.
Mm-hmm.
Through guiding and counseling systems,
mm-hmm.
through open systems.
Yes.
But we have majorly been raised in a system where the first thing that the police, we have grown up in this where the police are these strong and hard people to a level where Kenyans believe they are just a hard stone. So you realize that because of the challenges they go through, add on to the normal family and maybe you find that there are other challenges at work, corporate pushes and all that stuff. We need a system that can also provide mental programs to support them.
Yes.
Because most of them you realize, even some of the things that they do on the road, some of the things that they do on the road are things that actually you look at them and you realize this person needs help.
Mm.
But as Kenyans, we have a system that... that has refused to accept that everyone needs help. So help is basically like reserved for the poor, for the weak.
I want us to finish on sports desk, and I love local sports more than the international sports. I don't know what about you, maybe, but I'm told here that your team, I don't know whether it's your team, Ingwe, like is in the depression for. I love how this guy, or do I say I admire, how this person gave it a headline that there's trouble building at the den. No den belongs to the Leopards. Eh?
Yeah.
That there's a team called Bidco United that just came to the Premier League recently, and they did beat Ingwe 3-1. Now that we have a person from Western on set, tell us what you think about Ingwe. That's all we are going to discuss about sports.
I think on Ingwe, the problems are largely political.
Political?
We have people who have always used AFC Leopards as a stepping stone into politics.
Yes.
So you realize they'll come around, create a lot of hullabaloo around it, present themselves as the people, and then at the same time you realize that the management part still lacks, and that's why I'm saying political, because we have people who come with political ideas,
yes.
but then they don't implement the management issues that a club requires.
Mm-hmm.
So you realize that the club, as big as it is, it lacks the management structures that can ensure that it's a going concern.
Do you think this problem cuts across all clubs in Kenya?
It cuts across most of the clubs, except maybe for a few. Like those that are owned in a corporate way, like KCB.
Okay.
You realize that clubs like KCB, maybe Bandari,
uh-huh.
even when Eli came around
mm-hmm.
with Sofapaka,
mm-hmm.
there was a bit of professionalization.
Mm-hmm.
The issues were minimal, the organization. But now you realize the Ingwe, there are wars everywhere. So
yes.
you realize, even I admire what is happening at Gor. There's a way, there's some organization
yes.
that even encourages the fans
mm-hmm.
to mobilize resources for the club.
Yes.
You know, that's the kind of, that's how football is. Football is a family venture where you come together. But now there's the divisions among us Ingwes, the usual fights among us, the politicians in Western, it reflects on the performance of Ingwe. Because when they come together, everyone comes with their own agenda and their own ideas and personal desires.
Thank you. We are going to leave it there for now. That was what is there in the newspapers for you. I said I'm standing in for Rama Guko, who is a bit ailing, and we wish him quick recovery. So briefly after this, we are going to come back with youth and politics with myself, Kennedy, and another person I respect called Obare Thomas, who was my leader at the University of Nairobi, was my governor at the University of Nairobi. So we are going to come back, and for now, don't touch that tile.